Today, in this introduction session to Big Data and Hadoop, we are going to talk about these topics. Okay, this is the agenda for our today's session. So in this session, we are going to talk about what is Big Data, and then what type of data that you can call as a Big Data, and then is there any limit about that, and then the process that limit. Okay, what you call the data like that. And then, so what is Hadoop? Why Hadoop is more efficient and then effective in dealing with the big data? Why traditional systems are not able to do that? Okay, and then why companies are aggressively moving towards using Hadoop for their big data needs? Okay, well, for their big data storage and processing needs. Okay, so and then we are going to talk about the key breakthroughs of Hadoop over the traditional technologies like your applications developed using your Java framework or .NET frameworks or your database management, different kinds of RDBMSs. Okay, and then future of Hadoop as a participants are like the knowing about the knowledge, if you know about Hadoop, what is our future and then what is the company's wise, how they are getting benefited out of using Hadoop, what are the advantages if they implement at their point, cost wise and then scalability wise and flexibility wise, lot of other advantages that we are going to talk about in today's session. Okay, and then the course, what are the major components of this Hadoop which is making it happen in order to implement handle any type of business requirements. So what are the basic components provided by this Hadoop framework? So what it will do? So in order to meet the different types of requirements, in order to deal with the different types of the data, what are the basic components that we are going to use as a separate ecosystems called separate components, how they are installed and then how they are configured. So that is kind of a vast subject, but in today's class we are going to talk about the basic components of Hadoop and then which by using those components how you are getting benefited in order to meet your business requirements. So in this we are going to talk about those and the deliverables. Okay, what are the deliverables when you are trying to learn the Hadoop through Knowledge Hut or something, and then what are the deliverables we are going to do from our side? Okay, these are the topics that we are going to talk about today. Okay, so let us talk about big data. Okay, so what is big data? It is a keyword used for large volume of data or massive amount of the data or very huge data, huge in the sense. Okay, so if it is the beyond the capability of a single physical machine, okay, to store and process such a huge data is called big data. That means there is a limitation when you are using a single server for storing the data and processing the data using some traditional tools like your database management tools or like you develop the applications using some Java technology or .NET technologies or some other technologies in which you are using a single physical machine like your either IBM mainframe or your Teradata machines or some other high-end processors, the machines which are having high-end processors. But so you are using a single physical machine in order to store the data physically in the hard disk and then process the data, okay, using high-end processors. But there is a limitation. There is a limitation for the hardware capacity. You cannot, even though if you pour millions of dollars, so you cannot buy a machine, okay, of 2 terabytes of RAM. Okay, the maximum that we can get is today is 1 terabyte of GB RAM. So if you wanted to process 2 terabytes at a time, so you don't have enough storage space. That is beyond the beyond its capability of a single physical machine which is having 1 terabyte of RAM. So that's why there is a limitation there. If it is beyond its capability to store and process such a huge data, it is called big data. That means you need to have a different alternative to handle that kind of very big data in order to store physically and then process all that data at a time if it is your requirement, which is cannot be done by a current traditional technologies like your RDBMSs or some other tools. Okay, so here this is the good definition about the big data. Data for a collection of data sets so large and complex that it becomes difficult to store and process using on-hand database management tools or traditional data processing applications. We just touched based on this just now. Okay, the term for a collection of a data set so large data sets, okay, which is the beyond the capability of that particular single physical machine. Okay, large data sets you wanted to store and then process, and then the complex data, complex in the sense you can complex. Okay, so the complex in the sense, okay, what is the complex data? Can be categorized into three types. One is structured data, semi-structured data, and unstructured data. Okay, structured data is coming from the databases, which is following some data integrity rules. That means in the first column, if you wanted to store only the integer data, second column you can store only alphanumeric values, the third column date data type, or something like that. Data is fixed in that particular column and you are storing the data in a tabular format, so your data is following some data integrity rules. That means data coming from your, taken from your RDBMS databases, or okay, you have the data which can be loaded into an RDBMS data. That means that is following some data integrity rules. That data is called structured data. Okay, so RDBMS data, semi-structured data. Okay, so it looks like structured, not completely structured, and then not completely unstructured. Like your Excel file. Excel, if you load the data into Excel file by reading a database, that is a structured data. If you type it in, okay, then you can enter any data in the first column, second column, which cannot be loaded into a database. That's why it comes under semi-structured data. Okay, and then Excel. Okay, it is some structured format it will have, so that you can load the XML files into your database, or okay, you can build an XML file by taking the data from a traditional RDBMS. That data is called semi-structured data, XML files. And then the third one is JSON. In that you can store the arrays of values and then arrays and lists and all. That is also became a standard JSON file JSON file format. Those comes under semi-structured data. Unstructured data means the data like, okay, anything other than these structures and semi-structured, like your text messages, audios, videos, pictures, images, and the data generated by your cell phones, data generated by flights, and then data generated by signaling systems, skybox images. All this data comes under unstructured data. Okay, so that data, that is complex data, that comes under complex data, which is not able to process by the traditional systems. When you try to do some image processing, your systems will become slower down, and then it needs a lot of memory, and then it is beyond the capability of the physical machine. Okay, that's what it is mean, it meant by complex data. Okay, so that it becomes difficult to store. So because it is takes big data, it needs a lot of storage space which cannot be handled by your single physical machine. And then if you wanted to process all that data at a time, okay, you cannot process it because you don't have the high-end processors. You cannot build a machine which is more than one terabyte of your RAM. Okay, that means it is beyond the capability. So that means you need to have an alternative in order to process, which is like a Hadoop, which uses a distributed architecture. Okay, a distributed architecture. In a couple of minutes, we are going to talk about the Hadoop, and then you come to know how it is implementing the things, how it is addressing all these challenges faced by the traditional industry. So how it is becoming so familiar, why companies are aggressively moving towards using this Hadoop for their big data storage and processing needs. Okay, so we are going to talk about the measurements of big data. We might be knowing, some of the people might be knowing all of them, but we might be knowing, some of the people might know about just GB and TB, and then some people might know about the petabytes. These are the other measurements, because enormous amount of the data is getting generated nowadays when compared to 1998. We are going to talk about the comparisons of the 1990 and 2010 in the next slide. Okay, so in this one we are going to talk about this, how many bytes converted into bytes. Okay, 1 gigabyte equal to 10 to the power of 9 bytes, 1 terabyte equal to 10 to the power of 12 bytes, and then 1 petabyte equal to 10 to the power of 15 exponential. 10 into 10 like 15 times, and then exabyte equal to 10 to the power of 18 bytes, and then jettabyte equal to 10 to the power of 21 bytes. That means 1 jettabyte equals to, okay, so 1 trillion gigabytes, GB, 1 trillion GB. Okay, so that is the measurement. Okay, 1 jettabyte equal to 1 trillion GB, gigabyte. So total data generated throughout the world at the end of 2010 as per Information Data Corporation is 1.2 jettabytes of the data. When comes to end of 2014, it became nearer to 4 jettabytes. That means more than doubled. Okay, within just 3 to 4 years. You can imagine how much of ANA, because the storage space becomes so cheaper, and then there are a lot of technology enhancements, lot of data is getting generated from different sources, like we discussed before, like your signaling systems, security sensors, and then the social networks like say, Facebook, Twitter, and LinkedIn, and the skybox images, the data generated by flights, data generated by your cell phone conversations. Okay, these are all the main sources of getting large amount of the data, which cannot be handled by a single physical machine. Okay, so and then what is Hadoop, how it is addressing the things, we are going to talk about it. Okay, so these are the statistics that I collected from a trusted websites. Okay, Facebook, 6 billion messages per day, 400 petabytes of the petabytes of the data per month. You can imagine when you think about 1 year of data, that means almost 12 into 4, okay, like the 4,800 petabytes of the data per month, and the Google creates 250 to 300 petabytes of the data per month. Okay, that means, so when you gather 10 years of the data, you can imagine this definitely beyond the capability of a single physical machine. You have to use some distributed architecture. Okay, different. You have to use multiple machines in order to share the load instead of overloading a single physical machine, which cannot be possible by that machine in order to store the data and process the data. Okay, so these are the big data journey, how it is evolving, how much data is getting generated nowadays when compared to the 1990s. Okay, in 1990. Okay, as per IDC, Information Data Corporation, statistics, okay, per person on an average, they used to store 1400 MB, okay, at the transfer speed of 4.5 MB per second with the existing technologies available at that point, read the entire drive in just 5 minutes, with the technologies available at that time. When comes to 2010, okay, they used to store 1 terabyte of the data. That means storage capabilities has been increased. Okay, on an average per person, they used to store at 1 terabyte of the data at a transfer speed of 100 MB per second with the existing technologies available at that time. Read the entire drive in 3 hours, because storage capabilities has been improved, but the processing capabilities are not up to date. That means the customer does not wait for 3 hours. They expect that processing should be completed within 5 minutes, or 5 minutes or less than 5 minutes. So, or otherwise they look for the alternatives. Okay, Hadoop is already there from 2006 onwards. The practical implementations of Hadoop technology, Hadoop framework, is started from 2000 6 onwards. The Facebook and the Yahoo has taken the, okay, so used this Hadoop for their big data needs. Okay, so in 2010, okay, in order to store and process that 1 terabyte of the data using 100 drives, because it is using distributed architecture in which you are using multiple machines which are connected through a LAN network. Okay, so one machine will be acting as a master and then all other machines will be acting as slaves which will accomplish the things. So that means in this technology you are not going to overload any single physical machine. Based on its capability, you are storing a certain piece of the data in the first machine, second machine, third machine, fourth machine, like that. Okay, it is kind of a master-slave architecture. Okay, so how it works, it is kind of a big subject, the architectural part, but I will give you some introduction about this architecture, how it is accomplishing the things in a couple of minutes when we are talking about Hadoop. Okay, this is about big data. You might have understand what is big data. If it is a beyond the capability of a single physical machine in order to store and process such a huge data is called big data. Okay, that means you need an alternative technology which can handle the data to store physically and process it for doing the for process it means big data analytics. Okay, so now we are going to talk about Hadoop. Hadoop, what is Hadoop? Okay, and then how it is simplifying the things. It is an open source software framework, okay, which is used for storing the data and large scale processing of the data sets. Okay, on clusters of commodity hardware. Clustering means bringing together all these machines connected through a LAN network which will be acting as a single unit, and then by sharing the resources, by sharing the resources in the in terms of storage and processing, they are accomplishing the things by using a commodity hardware. What do you mean by commodity hardware? Which is available in the local market. You don't need to pour millions of dollars in buying the expensive hardwares like your Teradata hardware or your mainframe machines. Pretty expensive. Here you can use an assembled machines, like you can buy a 500 GB or 256 GB hard RAM machine, and then 20 terabyte of hard disk, and then a 16 core or 32 core machines. The processors, and then assemble them and then use it as one of the data nodes. That means one of the slaves. It is kind of a master slave architecture. One master will be there. Out of, if you have 100 node cluster, means 100 machines, okay, out of them one will be acting as a master which will be controlling all these data nodes. So in order to distribute the data among cluster of machines. Okay, so that is what happening in this technology using this Hadoop framework. So the daemon processes which are running behind the scenes will make it happen in order to store the data in a distributed way. Okay, that means what is going to happen when you copy a 1 terabyte of file into Hadoop distributed file system. Okay, it is through this software they are providing a distributed file system. Okay, a distributed file system. Okay, in which you are going to copy a file from your local file system, which is Linux file system, to this logically created Hadoop distributed file system. Okay, when you copy 1 terabyte of file, so through this framework, the daemon process which is running behind the scenes, what they will do? Okay, they will divide the data into small chunks called blocks. Each block size is by default 64 MB, and then you can configure to have 128 and then 256 or 512, multiples of 64 MB through configuration files when you are in installing Hadoop. Okay, so that means that 64 MB blocks will be spread among the cluster of machines by the master. Master will divide that file into small pieces, and then based on the capability of single multiple machines which are connected through a network, and then distribute among those machines based on their availability, storage space availability, and then based on their capability to process the data. And then, okay, by default, it keeps three copies. You don't need to worry about the disaster recovery, because if you lose one copy, automatically it keeps another two copies, and then there is a fail-safe mechanism which will work behind the scenes, and then automatically what is the data, whatever the data that you lost on that failed machine, okay, will be re-replicated to other available live nodes. That means if you wanted to keep three copies, means this framework will make sure that all these three copies are kept, so that your data is not lost. That's why availability and the reliability of the machine is accomplished by this. So more availability, like it is in the generation 2 of Hadoop, so availability is 99.9999%. So this system never fails. If one copy fails on the failed machine, automatically the software will make sure that that copy is re-replicated to other available live data nodes. Three copies are kept by default, and then your data is distributed, your one file data is stored on more than one machine. And then when you ask for that file from your local file system like Linux file system, okay, so all these blocks will be integrated by the framework, the name node, which is a master machine, and then will give you the entire file. When you process the file also, what is going to happen? So it is going to process each block, and then it implements a parallel processing concept, which is called a MapReduce concept. Okay, it implements a parallel processing concept. Okay, this master will provide the enough resources by taking other machines' resources, and then it will give it to this machine where this processing is done. So that the resources sharing will be happening behind the scenes. Okay, in terms of storing and processing. Storing wise, we talked about, right? So your data is divided into small chunks called blocks, and then which is spread among the cluster of machines. That way one file data is stored more than machine, one machine, and then because the machine, the data is stored in multiple machines related to one that file, then definitely you have to use a parallel processing concept in order to complete processing of all those blocks which are available in different machines, so that you will be processing all that file data, and then all these blocks which are processed in different machines will be collected by the framework to collect and then form an integrated file. Okay, so which is the output of your processing results. So when you write the code using either Java or C, C sharp, Python, R language, Ruby, these are all the languages which can be used to write your programs in order to process your data. For doing that big data analytics, you use either of these languages. Or so Hadoop framework has gave us some internal scripting languages in order to implement big data analytics. Okay, so now, so here we are, let us come back to this Hadoop. It is an open source software framework. What do you mean by open source? It is entirely free software, and then you can download the software from any of the distributors like Apache, which is an entirely open source Apache, or the major distributors like Cloudera, MapR, or Hortonworks. And then IBM has its own product called IBM Big Insights, like Green Plum, different flavors of Hadoop. So all these companies will provide you for free. That Hadoop software is free. The underlying operating systems that you are going to use in order to build your Hadoop cluster is like Linux, Fedora Linux, Ubuntu Linux, CentOS are entirely free. But if you use Red Hat, they are charging for that. Okay, like that you can use any open source softwares, or if you wanted to use Red Hat, you can use it. for building your Hadoop clusters. Okay, so those softwares are free, and then MySQL is free when they developed this software. Now Oracle bought it, they are charging in future. Okay, so like that, all the software that you are going to use here are an open source software framework. That means you can download the source code also and modify them as per your requirements to meet your business requirements. Okay, so that means that's what an open source means. And then community to hardware, that means we already talked about this. You can buy them buy separately, assemble, and then assemble the components and then use it as a one of the slave nodes. Okay, which will be used for storing the data and processing the data. Okay, Anik, so that means it is mainly Hadoop is mainly used as a batch processing system. It is not, the intention is not to build an online transaction processing application, sir. That means it will not support, even though one of the ecosystem is supporting OLTP, it is mainly designed as a batch processing system. This elsewhere, like your Facebook implementation. Okay, so you get the data from your traditional applications, like your Oracle database or some other database store, and then through scripts or some schedulers, the data will be moved into Hadoop, and then you do further processing with large volume of the data, because Hadoop can handle any amount of the data. Okay, handle it, and then process the result again moved back to the online transaction processing application. That's why your Facebook implementation is on Hadoop is like that. They are using Hadoop as a middle layer for processing the big data if they need to. Okay, because that cannot be handled, that much of large volume that cannot be handled by that OLTP applications like your RDBMS or the applications developed using Java framework or .NET frameworks. Okay, you do the processing in the middle layer, yeah, which is Hadoop, and then process result again move back to your OLTP applications. That's why Hadoop is mainly designed as a batch processing system, and then which is mainly used for storing the data physically in a distributed way, and then processing the data in a distributed way using the parallel processing concept. That means at a time you are processing only 64 MB data, even though your file is having 2 terabytes of file. That means, so instead of processing 2 terabytes or 1 terabyte of file at a time, so definitely it will take less time to process 64 MB block size data. Whatever the code you write will be processing at a time 64 MB blocks. All these blocks will be processed simultaneously by the framework, and then integrated output will be returned to again Hadoop distributed file system, which is replicated by default 3 times. You have 3 copies, or you can keep 2 copies if you want to, and then you don't have enough storage space available for keeping 3 copies. Okay, so that is about the definition of Hadoop. Okay, it is an open source software framework for storing, which is used for storing the data and large scale processing of data sets on clusters of community hardware. That is the definition of Hadoop. Okay, history of Hadoop. Okay, so in 2008, okay, so it became the Apache's top level project. How it is came from? Actually, in 2004, okay, so the Google publishes the white papers on the Google file system and MapReduce framework. Okay, Google file system is a distributed file system that they used. That means they used multiple machines in order to store the data, and then they implemented a MapReduce programming paradigm concept, which will be used for processing all these blocks which are stored in different machines parallelly, and then integrate the output. That concept has been given by the Google. That means the practical implementation has been already started released in at least 1998. And then they released these white papers, and then in Budokating and his team members, Tom White and then Mike Caffarella, taken this concept from Google, and then developed a nudge search engine. After successful implementation, Yahoo hired Dow Cutting and his team members to implement Yahoo groups into Hadoop. And then after successful implementation, okay, so they contributed the software to open source Apache. And then from 2008 onwards, it became top level Apache project. And then lot of ecosystems, multiple components in this framework has been built in order to meet the user requirements. So one point solution for all this, all big data solutions, like all the big data solutions. Okay, they develop different tools. Okay, this is about the atypical Hadoop clusters. Your multiple machines will be put it in racks, multiple 30 machines in one rack and then another 30 machines in one rack, like that. So they will be connected to different switches, and all will be connected to main switch. Okay, so that means you are using multiple machines to share the load in terms of storing and processing. This is called a network topology, based on the capacity of the cluster and then how much data that you are handling, storing in this Hadoop cluster. You do the capacity planning. Okay, what the individual capacity of the machines, and then how much data that you are bringing in, based on that you do the capacity planning, and then how complex data you are processing, based on that you decide about the processors, high-end processors that you are using, or RAM machines that you are using. But you are using a distributed architecture, and then using multiple machines in order to store and process. Okay, so why Hadoop come into pictures? That's what I'm going to talk about. Current challenges and how Hadoop addresses. Okay, so what the current challenges are called? Okay, 3 V's. Okay, 3 V's. So volume, amount of the data, total amount of the volume. When the volume becomes so big, and then so your single physical machine cannot handle it, and then either system crashes or hangs up. Okay, so the velocity, speed of data in and out, speed of data in and out, that means the frequency at which the data flows. Like Twitter, when a celebrity post a tweet on the Twitter, large of followers will respond to that and then overload the system. Then if they are not able to, their servers are not capable of taking those many transactions, that system hangs up, like your IRCTC site. Okay, that is also at 10:30 Tatkal reservations, you cannot do that because large number of hits, and then the capability of that machine is not so good, and then they cannot handle it, and then so you cannot do any reservations at 10:30. Okay, like that. That is talks about the velocity, variety of the data. And that, so like we discussed about the data, different data types, complex data, like structured data, semi-structured and unstructured data. When it comes to unstructured data, image processing, it becomes so difficult for the traditional systems in order to process the data. Okay, Hadoop provided different APIs, application program interface, and a lot of APIs for dealing with different types of input data. Okay, so that way how Hadoop addresses using this distributed architecture, and then using the different type of different Hadoop components, you are able to deal with any data types like structured data, semi-structured data, and unstructured data. So you might have understand right now at this point. So you are using, in order to store the data, you are using multiple machines, and then your data is divided into blocks. That way, based on the capability of these machines, the data will be distributed among the cluster of machines. Okay, so which is done by the daemon processes which are running behind the scenes in this Hadoop framework. Okay, now we are going to talk about the how it is scalable, because it is scalable. Any amount of the data can be stored because you are not overloading any physical machine. Based on its capability, the multiple machines, so the name node, which is called master, will distribute among multiple machines. That's why it is scalable enough. See, if you are having some petabytes of data coming up, so that keep on adding one more machine in the network, that's it. Add the multiple data nodes like that. Commission, add and commission the data nodes, multiple data nodes, so that there is no scalability issues in terms of storing and then processing. Processing also at 64 MB, and then you are faster, because only at a time you are processing 64 MB, because you are implementing a parallel processing concept, you are winning the race in speeding up the process here when you use Hadoop framework for processing your data. Okay, that way it is providing a scalability. It means there are 50,000 node clusters available at this point, which will be acting as a single physical machine, which will be acting as a single machine, but the data is distributed among the 50,000 machines. You can understand, imagine how much data you can process at a time. That means 10 machines which are connected through a network, that means each 1 GB means you have 10 GB of RAM machine. So you are solving the issues using this distributed architecture. And then availability. Your availability is more, because like I said, it is implementing a fail-safe mechanism. Once it is, any data in the distributed architecture, any machine can fail through either network failure or hardware failures. Whatever the data blocks which are stored in that machine will be re-replicated to other available data nodes by the framework. That's why it is, your processing also will not be stopped. Okay, so automatically it will process the second copy if first copy fails. So that way it is providing 99.9999% availability in the second generation of Hadoop. It is reliable. You can just trust on this machine. It never stops. You don't need to worry about it. Just put the data in Hadoop and process the data. You don't need to worry about anything. This architecture or the daemon process, the programs which are behind running behind the scenes will take care of you. Are providing the fail-safe mechanism. And then cost effective. Why it is cost effective? You are using an open source software and then commodity hardware. So you don't need to buy for millions of dollars in buying the hardwares like your Teradata machines, or millions of dollars in buying the softwares like your expensive Oracle databases or some other expensive softwares. Okay, so all the softwares which are used in this Hadoop are open source. That's why the cost savings are 90 to 99%. So definitely the companies will move towards using this Hadoop because of all these advantages. At the same time, cost effective, and then flexible. It is flexible enough to handle any type of data, like your structured data, semi-structured data and unstructured data. It is faster. Why it is faster? It is at a time processing only 64 MB, and then blocks and then implementing a parallel processing concept. That's why it is faster. Definitely it is 100 to 300 times faster than the traditional systems, based on how complex data that you are processing because of this architecture. And then it is resilient to failure, like I said. So if any copy fails, automatically you can use another two copies. Another second copy. In the meantime, the framework will take care of re-replicating the data which is failed on that machine. So it is resilient. Because of all these advantages, the Hadoop, so everybody is moving towards using Hadoop for their big data storing and processing needs. Okay, so these are the key breakthroughs of Hadoop. Okay, I may take another 10 minutes, because we lost like 5 to 10 minutes. We started a little late because of the strength. Okay, so I may take another few minutes of your time after 9:10, up to 9:10 or 9:15. Okay, so Hadoop provides 4 key breakthroughs compared to traditional solutions. Okay, I have taken this image from MapR, which is one of the major distributors of Hadoop. They are also taken the open source software from Apache, and then these distributors like Cloudera, MapR, and then Hortonworks developed some associated tools, like in order to make the developer's life easier. They have developers multiple plugins, some of the tools for managing the clusters. So these are the major distributors: Cloudera, MapR, and Hortonworks. Okay, so these are the advantages. Overcomes the traditional limitations of storage and computing by implementing this distributed architecture. Okay, because you are not overloading any single physical machine here when you use Hadoop. Okay, the second main advantage is leverage inexpensive commodity hardware as the platform. That's why you don't need to spend millions of dollars in buying the expensive hardwares like Teradata. Okay, the third one provides linear scalability from 1 to 4,000 servers in the first generation of Hadoop. Like I said, in the second generation, there is no limitations where they are using a resource management technology like ION technology. So, proper allocation of the resources will be done in the by implementing the ION technology. The second generation of Hadoop, we are using ION, in which there is no limitation for the number of servers. Like I said, 50,000 node Hadoop clusters are available. Okay, multiple name nodes and then multiple data nodes. So your system never fails. Okay, so and then the fourth one is low cost and open source software, because cost effective open source software, because you don't need to spend millions of dollars in buying the expensive softwares. These are the key drivers. Now, industry sectors which are using Hadoop. Okay, search engines like your Yahoo search engine, MSN search engine, or Google. They are using Hadoop for the Hadoop technology, this distributed architecture, for their storage and processing needs. Social networking sites like your Facebook, LinkedIn, and Twitter. Finance and banking industry, your Bank of America data is already in Hadoop, and then Wells Fargo, they are converting their applications into Hadoop, and HSBC, they are working on converting their applications into Hadoop, and then American Express are already working on moving their entire financial data into Hadoop. That means it is secure like your traditional systems, and then all the data warehouses using the Hive, one of the ecosystem in Hadoop, which will take care of the RDBMS data. Okay, for that, all the financial data and retail industries data like your Walmart is into Hadoop now. And then e-commerce applications like your eBay and Amazon, they are using Hadoop. Email services are using Hadoop. And the security sensors data for image processing and all, they are using Hadoop. And then government and public sector. Public sector data, American federal government data is in Hadoop right now, and the Indian Aadhaar card data is in Hadoop now. Okay, so it is not specific to particular industries. There are successful implementations of this Hadoop software in these major clients, major companies like AOL, eBay, Twitter, IBM, Amazon, Facebook, LinkedIn, Yahoo, and Adobe. These are our companies, big industries which are using Hadoop, so that the people who are coming forward to learn or implement this Hadoop, they don't need to worry about the security issues. There are already practical and successful implementation has been already done from 2006 onwards, and then a lot of developments is being done in this area to integrate any ecosystems like ETL tools or business intelligence tools. You can integrate with the available business intelligence tools. Okay, so these are the industries. And then the future of Hadoop. So I have taken this graph from Indeed.com, job trends. So how much jobs are getting created in future, next couple of years? What is the role of this big data analytics using this Hadoop? Okay, 33% of the companies are already using Hadoop. Another 20% of companies have started their development in Hadoop at a CAGR, compound annual growth rate. Okay, at a 58%, the usage of Hadoop is increasing year by year. By 2018, $16 billion will be spent on big data. Okay, Hadoop is the main alternative in order to store and process such a huge data, because it is using a distributed architecture. These are the jobs. Okay, first place is cloud computing, and then second place is in Hadoop. Third place is in JPA, Java Persistent API. The third one, fourth one is, which is going consistently, enterprise Java beans. Okay, so your Hadoop can be put it in cloud. You can use Amazon EC2 or S3 in order to build your Hadoop cluster manually, or you can use their product Elastic MapReduce, which is having all the ecosystems, or you can build your clusters, cloud computing, and then Hadoop separately you can build your own Hadoop clusters apart from cloud. Okay, it is one of the top three technologies in the world right now. So you can get into, okay, your Hadoop development if you are a programmer. Okay, you can get into Hadoop for doing the big data analytics by using, if you know any of the languages like C, C Sharp, Java, Python, Ruby, or R technology. Okay, so or any traditional RDBMS tools like your Oracle database or some MySQL knowledge, SQL knowledge. You have a place in Hadoop. You can work, you can build your data warehouses using Hadoop technology. Yeah, that means you can store the data in a tabular format. Okay, you can get into the testing. If you are a basically a testing background, you can test MapReduce applications using MR unit. They have provided some tools to test your MapReduce applications. I mean distributed processing model. You can test these applications, Hadoop MR MapReduce applications. Okay. And then you can become an administrator, basically if you are from a Linux background. Okay, the course curriculum. So what the means course curriculum means the basic components of Hadoop. HDFS is mainly a distributed file system that runs on large clusters of commodity hardware. Okay, so it is like your Linux file system. Okay, all the commands like your ls command, which will be used for listing all the files and directories, your chmod for giving the permissions like read, write and execute permissions on the files, okay, your copy command, move command, all these commands will work with by calling some classes. That means you don't need to, there is no learning curve for working with this file system. If you are familiar with Linux or some other operating system, and then you are familiar with the HDFS, how to retrieve the data and then copy the data into Hadoop distributed file system. And then MapReduce, which is used for implementing a distributed parallel processing concept. Okay, so your blocks, like I said, your blocks, your whatever the code that you have written will be processing at a time, just 64 MB data, like that, the framework will be implementing a parallel processing concept. That's why your all these processed output from different machines will be integrated by the framework in order to form the total output file. So that MapReduce, HDFS is mainly used for storage and MapReduce is used for processing the data. These two main ecosystems are important. When you install Hadoop automatically, these two systems are automatically come because you need it. One is storing the data, which is, and then processing the data, which is implemented by these two ecosystems, HDFS and MapReduce. The next one is PIG. Okay, it is a data flow language like your program. When you are in Hadoop, your PIG session, okay, so one command's output will be taken as an input to second command, like that. You're implementing a data flow here, okay. Here you are going to use a script language called PIG Latin, okay. Non-programmers, like who are not programmers, can use this PIG, and then very minimum learning curve, 4 to 5 days, if you are non-programmers. Whatever the thing you can do, what are the big data analysis you can do using a programming languages in which you are going MapReduce, you can implement the same using PIG, a scripting language, just 4 to 5 days minimum learning curve for learning PIG. Okay, so it is kind of a replacement system for MapReduce, which is used for processing the data. All types of the data, like structured data, semi-structured data, and unstructured data. Okay, the fourth one is Hive, which is more important systems. Lot of banking data is they are moving their current warehouses data into this Hive data warehouse, which is implementing a data warehousing environment in Hadoop, and then all your tables data in Hive is stored under HDFS. So there is no limitation, any big tables data you can store, because all these files which are accessed by these high tables will be stored in HDFS, which is stored in a distributed way. Okay, so if you are comfortable with SQL, you are comfortable with high data records, the programmers, SQL programmers are okay. They are good to go. They can use this Hive for their building their warehouse. Okay, they converting lot of applications are converting their applications from current data warehouses in which they are using Oracle or some other databases are getting moved in this Hive data warehouse. Okay, it is Hive is a distributed data warehousing framework, which is built on top of Hadoop. Okay, next is Scoop ecosystem. These all these ecosystems go as separate installations based on your need. If you are using that ecosystem like Pig, you install the software and then use it. Okay, and then Scoop, it is one more ecosystem which is installed separately. The main purpose of this tool is to bulk transfer of the data, structured data like your database data from your traditional RDBMS to Hadoop and then Hadoop to a traditional RDBMS, like import and export. Import is the process of copying the data from your tables by reading the other databases tool, the tables data, and then placing it in Hadoop distributed file system. Or you can copy that entire table into your Hive data warehouse. So it is mainly used for import and export, and a lot of other features also, other tools also available in Scoop in order to do a different kinds of tasks. Okay, so next ecosystem is HBase. Okay, HBase, a distributed column oriented database, because so it is very high performance database, and then it is implementing a NoSQL concept. NoSQL means not only SQL, which is opposite to your traditional RDBMS, but whatever you can get using your RDBMS, you can use everything in HBase. You can get everything in by implementing HBase. So the data will be stored in tables, but it is not RDBMS. There's no joins, no group by, no subqueries, so no logic, simply. Okay, so everything will be stored in one table, and then you bring the data, and then very high performance because no constraints, no data types, no joins, no subqueries, which is slowing down your process. That's why Google has created a big table for high performance, and then they have taken that Google's big table concept and then built this HBase, which is based on NoSQL concepts. Okay, here also it is using HDFS for its tables underlying data, Hadoop distributed file system, because which is distributed among the cluster of machines, which is accessed by your Hive tables or HBase tables. Okay, a Zookeeper, which is used for as a coordination service, and then which provides a proper distributed locking mechanism, which will be mainly used for speeding up the process. Based on the capacity of your other clusters, you will install a couple of instances of your Zookeeper. Okay, it is mainly used for as a coordination service and providing a distributed locking mechanism. Mainly, the main advantage is to speeding up the process, faster process. Okay, Ouji, they have developed a separate ecosystem which is used for scheduling the jobs. You developed multiple jobs, so one job's output will be taken as an input. Okay, like that, you will be using, like it is kind of a replacement your cron job or like Windows schedulers or Linux schedulers. Okay, because it is Hadoop is mainly designed as a batch processing system. Okay, they developed a separate scheduler. Okay, Ouji is a system for running workflows of dependent jobs. Okay, one after the other, which implements a project. Okay, and the next system is Plume, which is used for transferring the log data which is generated by the servers, like your web servers, database servers, or operating systems. okay, which will be used for bulk transfer of that log data in an incremental basis to your Hadoop distributed file system, one way. Okay, so that you can analyze the data and stop the using MapReduce programs and then stop the potential failures of those servers, log servers, the databases or database servers or your web servers or your operating system servers. Okay, Flume is one of the systems. Like that, they have developing lately lot of ecosystems like Impala, which is implementing in online transaction processing RDBMS. Okay, so these are all the ecosystems which will be used to deal with the different types of the data. Okay. Okay, so when you wanted to take the course from Knowledge Hut, we'll be providing a course material which is written by me, and then lot of practice exercises we'll be providing for making you practice, and then we will prepare you for the certification exams. Okay, lot of case studies, the practical implementations of each ecosystem.